Hello everyone, today I want to talk about a few features that were recently introduced in the latest code base of EOSIO. It's the contract whitelist and blacklist, plus the author whitelist and blacklist feature. This is a thing that allows block producers to fend off a few transactions that are destined to certain contracts or that come from certain authors or certain accounts. But first, let me just tell you a story of what happened yesterday. So yesterday we were orchestrating the launch, right? And it was a crazy time with all the community together. And we had an issue. The testnet we were testing sort of started forking. The node EOS locally thought it was all right, continued producing blocks. But the other ones receiving those blocks said, oh, unlinkable block, invalid signature. So like it was not a good time to have that. And so I poked a few folks' block, one responded and said, yeah, there's something there. And we dug, we cloned a copy of the chain there, we shared it around so people could try it, and we found out something that we absolutely need to share so that no one hits that issue anymore. It goes this way. So let me explain first the contract whitelist and blacklist feature. If you add that to your config.ini or on the command line, if you put that in your configuration file, so the contract will require a contract name. It could be EOSIO.token, for example. That would set up some whitelisting or blacklisting on that account. If you whitelist something, it will ignore any blacklists. So it means it's exclusive. You can only send transactions to that contract. If you add many whitelists, they're going to be added together so you can send only transactions to those few contracts. If you have a blacklist plus one whitelist, the moment you have one whitelist, the blacklist is ignored. Any blacklist statement is ignored. So if you want to blacklist some contract, like say there's a rogue contract, I don't know, stealing money, I don't know what, then you put a blacklist, and every block producer will need to do that to fend off transaction that tried to, run that contract. It's something that the block producers need to set on their own machine. So they need to call, maybe if there's an urgent matter, they need to call one another and say, hey, this contract needs to be blocked, put that config and restart your node. And this is the only way that those transactions will not get into any blocks. Because what could happen is that the transaction could be refused by someone who blacklisted a contract, but the next block producer will just put them in, right? So this needs to go through all the block producers and no one puts that transaction in. Now the other aspect is that is author whitelist and author blacklist. So this is a similar feature, but instead of checking the destination contract, it checks the source account, like who is using the permission, right? There's an author field when you send a transaction, says who is issuing that transaction and who signed it. So by doing that, you can prevent certain people from issuing transaction. Again, whitelist takes precedence over blacklist. You can have many of these, and you can blacklist a certain people. And that same thing also regarding block producers doing the setting there. Everyone needs to put the setting for that to be applied. Otherwise, it's just going to fall to the next block, and it's still going to be included. So the issue we had yesterday is that for testing purposes with a community, we started the node with contract whitelist nobody. That meant we only allowed transaction to the account nobody, which didn't exist, so that really no one could send transactions that would be included in any block. It's just a way to, block the chain so people can spec in read-only. The thing is, the system contract has a side effect. There's an onBlock method that the core chain calls inside the smart contract. And if this is not called, then there was an action mroot which was not updated. So it's an action that's built by the chain on each block ran by the system contract. If you whitelisted out the system contract, you would get into that situation, which would have created a big fork and mess. So we just need to know about that and not freeze the system contract. maybe there's some fix that can come out right later on. It's, we can work around it, but knowing it is like big part of solving the issue. So I think that's the most, if there's an issue up, I don't have the number, we'll put that maybe in the description. And Lockman is gonna put that in the next fields of improvements. It's not a blocker, so that was like one of our concerns there. It's not a blocker, so we can go out for a launch. We need to know that, like, please share that out, and we'll talk to you later. Okay, bye.